first the episode. On the back side of this, there were little images. So the first episode was performed in Venice, in a stationery, and the TV man talked about it and said, yeah, you know, maybe they performed it, they didn't know about it. Because they want not to be part of it. So the thing goes, if you would travel to all, it started in Venice and that ended in Santiago de Compostela, it was in Chile, everywhere, and if you go to all these places, you would find a certain link between these places. And also, if you would spend some time there, sure, you would get a trace. So it is like an experimental novel where everything is given except the story. Everything is there. The modest, the formal aspects of narration, everything is there, but not the story. And yeah, and for me it was also a way how to solve the problem that you sometimes want to do things and you have not the means to do it, you know, you cannot make a movie or whatever, but how can you make it? So that was one result just to make this thing and to distribute it. And it was, in some of the places people appeared for openings and just made a party, in Rome for example, without any reason. I mean, there was, I was not there. So this was Piazza di Plebiscito, it's in the center of Naples, and today there's a kind of pedestrian area. And in the last 12 years, they were hosting, in December, art events, sculptures by Richard Serra, Anish Kapoor, and all other people. And in the last 2 years, they did not do it anymore, because the city council was not, there was a leftist city council at the beginning, then there was a Berlusconi council, and they cut off the money for them. And I found this postcard where this was still a parking lot in the 60s. So what I thought, and I know one of the curators, and they wanted to invite me, and they said, okay, we don't have money anymore, don't know what to do. And I said, we can do something without money. Published in the end. And this is page. This picture has a special thing. Because it's for two heads of piano. There is a third line. You see the middle. Mm-hmm. You cannot play. Because we have only two heads. So it's just on this page. All the other pages still have this voice. And what this is, he calls it, you see it up there. You cannot maybe read it very well. Innere Stimme. He calls it the inner voice. Mm-hmm. What it is while the pianist is playing it, they read this line. So if you don't know the notation as a person who is listening, you don't know about this. So it is a little bit like in the Romantic time, the hidden track at that time was a very common thing. And it has also to do with this theory of automats, you know, the chess player. You know, this story where this automat who won all the time and they found out there's a war inside who was playing it, like the Turk, the chess-playing Turk. But a lot of people believe that it's really the automat who is playing. It is really about Alan Turing's concept. What is the difference between a machine and a human being? You know the Turing test. Does anybody know? The Turing test is if you would communicate with somebody behind the screen and you don't see this person. How do you find out if this is a person or this is a machine? You find it out just by certain reactions. We come back to something we talked about in the beginning. So the Turing test says that computers are able to perform in a way that you think they are alive. That they can react to all the questions, just the question of capacity and how you construct the computers. So the Turing test says there is no distinction between life as we are and machines. Machines can be part of human life. So, and this is a today's reference to this kind of thing. So, and I found that very fascinating because the inner voice is also, when you remember the thing what we had, or I talked about the monk. The inner voice, you know, what is it there when you listen to yourself? Is it your inner voice, or is it the voice what you heard, that you remember, or is it what is it? So what I did, I isolated these things and just taped them and said, this is for me now, yeah, instruction for a performance. Mm-hmm. I'll give you this. This is just a text which I asked the philosopher to write about this, Jean-Luc Nancy. And so, well, I asked people to perform these sounds, this melody, permanently in an exhibition space. So they were invited to be in the space, dressed like you, but they were singing this line, three or four of them. And they were absolutely free how they move it, how they behave, and also to improvise. And I did a 30-hour performance. So there were all, after 2 hours, I don't know if you need a break, it's up to you.
Five minute break?
So it's not
just the concept in which something turns into art.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm specifically towards this project with the 10 spaces, where it's actually not, I mean, there is nothing, it's just the people, so it's about the social event.
Yeah.
But the question is, if, yeah, I mean, it's an empty gallery space where you just watch is themselves. So in this one, I didn't read it, but it's a medium thing where you have that part.
Yeah.
To a specific time.
Yeah.
Brunakis was born in Metagross on the island of Egina around 1860. As a child, he only knew the small towns of the island and the city of Piraeus. His mother occasionally took him along when she went there. He grew up without his father, who was away at sea, and only rarely visited the island. From time to time, his father sent considerable sums of money, enough for Adarkus and his mother to live comfortably, and also to buy some land. His youth was rather solitary. His younger sister died shortly after birth. It is not known whether he was named Alexis after his father or another close relative. His mother did not send Rodarcus to school, but instead had a private tutor who instructed him in elementary subjects and also taught him to draw. The lessons came to an end after only 4 years, and Rodarcus did not receive any further education. At the age of 15, Rodarcus decided to build a house of his own. He had gone to Piraeus, where he wanted to sign on a ship. Although he gave up this plan after only a few days, he did not return until several months later. He then informed his mother that he would not move back into her home. He said nothing further about his unexpected return, nor did he mention a reason for his decision to build.
The only thing which is certain is the future. Uncertain is the past. Yeah, of course, it exists when there is a future. I think this is the problem of manifesting, you know. If you want to manifest something, then it's recorded somehow. That's immediately a past seen from the future, or if you speculate about the future, it is more or less also just manifestation. You can manifest things. But being here right now, doing something right now, manifested as at both, it is in the past and the future at the same time.
Could you you also say in relation to work?
The time. You can short to identify something. So how is it possible that it goes from there to there? Yeah, how? Yeah, how is it possible that it is moving? If you describe it with this kind of identification of a space and a time, you cannot describe movement really. You describe a contradiction. Because what you do is, reflect. You reflect and reflect at the same time. But this is what you call dialectic. The contradiction is existing, it's not a problem. For me, I mean, that is my opinion. And in mathematics, you have the same thing. I mean, all of you learned in school integrals, right? Do you know what an integral is? Can you give it to me? I mean, you had it in school, I think, in the past 10 years.
Are you using a different word than I'm using?
Sinus, sinus.
Waveforms.
Waveforms, yeah, but the function of a waveform, what does it mean?
It describes an idea.
No.
It illustrates.
You have this, right? And then you have the crack. So, and the sinus function says the surface in here, you can calculate the size of the surface. That's the sinus function, right?
Yeah.
And how did you make it?
It's a proportion between the position, space, and time, no? I don't
know. Yeah, but when you want to calculate the given surface in a curve, you need a sinus function. But what does it mean, a sinus function? Normally, when you have this, right? You multiply this and this, and then you have the surface given. But how do you do it with a full curve?
An equation?
Yeah, you make little things. Which you make like you would edit them, but you do it like that they shrink more and more and more and more and more, and then you introduce this new value going to endless, going to zero, going to endless. That's the when you calculate the sinus function in math, did you say it's n plus and then n, and then you have like it is unlimited, and you could make this division unlimited. Obviously, I mean if you would think practically, this is not possible, but it's the only way how you can calculate it. This was the first time done by Leibniz. Newton and Leibniz did it at the same time. And then they were arguing who did it first and who was copying more, but nobody was copying, they did it independently. But they had the same problem, you know, that there was a much more manifold but it is also a point of emptiness, you know. It is where you want to see something like with this inner voice. It is empty. If you really start to listen to yourself, what is there? And you repeat and repeat and repeat, there's nothing. It's totally empty. Meditation. And then you can start and speculate what you mean in meditation. But at first, everybody who is doing meditation is describing the process of emptying, getting to the rhythm, you know. Rhythm, I think, is a very, very important thing. To structure things, time, use that rhythm, or you, and one of you was mentioning rhythm. Rhythm is a very, very strong way of... I mean, there's one piece maybe which could be not an answer, but a proposal. It has also the subtitle. Some proposals to answer important questions. So, I mean...
And actually, you can also say that time is what structures everything, so it doesn't happen at the same time, you know?
Yeah.
So in that way, I mean, time is the greatest structure of all, and that's history of rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
But it... Goodbye Lenin, the movie that they...
Yeah, this is
very... ...the time for one person...
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
but
it's quite interesting.
For example, this movie was very, very challenging and nice because I liked it a lot, but a lot of my friends didn't like it because they had this feeling you are not allowed to laugh about it.
Mm.
It's too serious. This happens. It's like if you have movies about serious things where people are traumatized from, they don't allow you to laugh about it because for them it is something totally different.
Mm.
But I think laughing is a great thing.
Yeah.
You can Yeah, I mean, but I liked it so much because it was the first attempt that you not take the whole thing so bloody serious, and that you make a bit fun of it, of yourself first, you know.
Yeah, I think sometimes humor helps a lot to me. I mean, also like Bella from Benigni or Candy B, that
yeah.
It's also, they're very much like ironical, but also very, very like.
What's wrong with you?
She's trying to think, thinking of like when there was a bombing in Belgrade.
Mm-hmm.
The grandmother of my friend, she kind of, I mean, she was too old and she couldn't actually accept it. So
yeah.
They wanted to protect her from it. So she didn't know that there was bombing. She couldn't hear well, so perfectly. So she just knew like nothing was happening. But then there is a hill next to Belgrade with a television tower, which is kind of a landmark of the city. And the tower got bombed. She's just standing on the balcony and she's like, but there's something strange. Oh, that the tower is missing. And my friend's mother just told me, oh no, they just took it down to paint it. They will put it
back.
That's very good.
It worked.
What should you say? I mean, you cannot make it better. I mean, very good. I mean, this is joke telling is very good in these cases.
Do you think that's something that can work across all cultures? Would be hard to say.
Yeah, you must share the concept.
I'd say it would be very interesting to find if such devices would work on different continents. Culturally, where I come from, recent modern history, there are a lot of dark stories, and people deal with humor very quickly, and there's a very dark sense of humor. Belfast was an island. So somebody could be killed in the morning, and you tell jokes about them by dinner time, which is okay, where I come from. But I'm not sure if the same devices would translate. I'm just wondering if anyone has experience of humor being used as a device for coping with your lens of the now in relation to events. And that's used as a is that used as a coping device in having not that well traveled, so I'm just wondering if people have experience of that also working in other cultures.
Well, actually, like at least in Yugoslavia, in Bosnia, I mean, the people from Sarajevo are known in the area as the people with the best humor. Like, whenever I would speak with someone from Sarajevo, I mean, I have to laugh, just the way the jokes that they make were completely into it.
Those kind of things. Who invented now socialism? The politicians, the philosophers, or the scientists? And then, you know, and then he said, okay, I have to think about it. And then he comes back and says, oh, we thought about it. The philosophers. And Oh, yeah, I thought so, because the scientists normally do the experiments first with the rats.
Yeah, but this thing, jokes are
so, then it's these kind of jokes, you know, where you, of
jokes
course, you put yourself in this position, and then you make a, but it needs also, not everybody is the kind of character who's dealing with them. But
I think there is a certain social censorship that actually doesn't really allow you to discriminate, and not to go through the jokes. So people are afraid. I mean, I don't know, at least like where I come from, it would make a lot.
Yeah, okay, I'm thinking about it. Well, this is a work where I'm not sure, but I had a bit of feeling that it was for myself dealing with it. And, can we do the
sort of Mr. Performer, that's why you even see that great kind of staging scenery. And in the last room there was a stable where you had on a very thin paper printed the score that people could take away and take note of them.
Humoresque?
I call it inner voice at ease. And in the first room you had this score frame, so when you enter it, you see this frame, it's very empty, and then in the last room you have to stay where you can take it, just to understand the setting.